What's up, nerdlings?
What up, nerdlings?
The question is, do you nerd for...
BransonCon 2020!
What is BransonCon? Well, it is a local convention that covers just about everything pop culture related, and it is right in the good city of Branson, Missouri. Go ahead, future Tom, and drop that Branson, Missouri joke right here.
Branson, Missouri.
No, Pelly. This is Branson, Missouri.
That's right. It's not Branson. It's Branson. It is the Las Vegas as run by Ned Flanders.
Branson, Missouri. My dad says it's like Vegas if it were run by Ned Flanders.
With the Simpson jokes out of the way, now we can get down to business. This is the second year of BransonCon, so their sophomore offering.
It is.
And from the first year, they have changed venues.
They did.
And to some degree, for the better, and to some degree, maybe not so much. They held BransonCon at the Welk Resort, which has a very nice theater.
It really does.
Yeah. Great stage, but it's not exactly set up for vendors.
No, that's kind of the downside. They kind of set it up in like the lobby of the theater and kind of some of the hallways.
Now, they made great use of that
space.
They pretty much utilized every last inch of space. That was good because they got all those vendors in there. But it did make some of the pathways just a little tight, which when you're walking by like a whole bunch of Lego minifigs, you start getting a little nervous that you're going to bump into that and knock everybody over.
Something else that was a little frustrating was the fact that it didn't have a very good flow. When there's a convention hall, you kind of have your rows, you can go up and down, and you know you've covered everything. This one was blocked off into two sections.
What divided those two sections? Now, first of all, hear us out. It was great having a restaurant on site, because if you didn't want to eat at the concession stand, which another great idea, because if you just want a quick snack, concessions right there. But if you wanted something more substantial, you have the restaurant.
The food was really tasty there.
However, me personally, if I were walking around and if I followed the convention into that restaurant, I wouldn't keep going thinking there's more convention. I would be like, oh, oops, sorry guys, I walked into the restaurant. And I might turn around and go back the way I came.
They did have a small sign, but it was only at one of the restaurant doors. And another neat thing, they basically had booth room service. If you were a vendor there, you could call the restaurant and they brought food to your booth.
And the vendors really did like that.
They did.
We found Chris from Telesplash.
Another good thing about the way things were set up, when you entered into this convention, you're right there. There was no question about where to go, you know, take these stairs down here, this elevator over there, you know, jump on that turtle shell to get to a higher ledge. None of that. But another downfall was once you got into that other vendor room, the one that was beyond the restaurant, it had a nice central access door that you would come in. But then it would kind of split off to either way. And that goes back to your earlier mention of not really having a good flow. It's not a big deal, but sometimes it can make a difference, you know, having that nice circle. Another thing to note was in either vendor hall, they had nice big windows and doors and everything. It did help to not feel so claustrophobic. The only time that was an issue was certain parts of the day, and that light's coming right in. Those rooms would get a little toasty. But there were some vendors in that first hall, and the ones on the other side, then it seemed to get a little dark. It may not have been that dark in there. It may have just seemed that way because of the windows having all of that extra light come in.
This is the happiest Iron Man I've ever seen.
That, again, is the venue's issue, not the con's issue. You're in a theater lobby, which is typically usually at night. It's a nice, darker ambiance. Basically, they had indoor street lights. And that was the only lighting that you had in there. So it looked cool, but for convention's sake.
Yeah, baby.
Machine gun jumpies? How'd I miss that?
called foreplay, you twit.
But like I said, not the convention's fault.
Hi, BransonCon. My name is Seymour Krailborn, and I represent Mr. Mushnick's Flower Emporium, and I'm here to show off our brand new plant. Its name is Audrey 2, and it's a really nice plant, but very, very friendly. And so if you ever want to see any more amazing plants, just come by the Flower Emporium. We would love to see you. I would love to see you too. As a matter of fact, I want someone to feed me. Thank you so much, BransonCon 2020. We love you.
BransonCon is a 3-day convention.
And honestly, I really do prefer at least 2 to 3-day conventions because I am always kind of indecisive where I think, no, I don't need that. But then most of the time it's 5 minutes later.
The other benefit to having a convention that is spread over multiple days can be some of the scheduling. If you have some of your celebrity guests, some of your authors and creators, if they're doing different panels or shows or anything, then it makes it a little easier to try to be able to catch more of those instead of having everything overlapping one another.
Or the fact that you either have to choose panels or convention floor because you don't have time for both necessarily.
One, two. Ooh, takes it with a grimace.
Glove slip. Baby glow slip.
Mm. That's very clever. I like that. Does he have a name?
This is Roxy. She's the runt of the litter.
Oh.
She doesn't have the voice box, so she can't do the big loud grunting. So we had to take her to school trips and that kind of stuff. We have to take her away from the others.
Oh. You're so cute, though.
Day one, Friday, had us getting up bright and early and heading straight to the convention because the thought was that you had a class to be
yes,
at.
Yes, my Forged in Foam with Bruce Holt, they had posted that the classes were going to start at 11 a.m. because it was going to be a longer class and they wanted to get them over with before the con started, which started at 3 o'clock.
We were actually staying at the resort and the theater was just a super quick walk from the resort itself. There seemed to have been a little bit of miscommunication about the class.
Yes, there were some, I guess, misprints on Facebook versus website. There were a lot of people actually walking in the door when we were there thinking that the convention was supposed to start at 11 as well. But I think it was a typo and they changed it, but I think they changed it too close to the time of the show. So people didn't catch that. But we got it all straightened out eventually.
Yeah, something to keep in mind, guys, is, again, this was BransonCon's second year. They were at a completely new venue. There's going to be a lot of issues to arise. The nice thing is, the people that we talked to, the Queen Nerd, she was incredibly nice, and she took the time to talk to us and everything. And it wasn't just us. There were multiple other people, and she made sure to talk to them. She wanted to make sure from the get-go that everybody, us included, were going to have an awesome weekend at BransonCon. And I really have to throw some props out to her because that is an incredible thing to do when we know you have so much other stuff going on, trying to get everything organized and ready to go before those doors open. Thank you so much for that.
The staff and the volunteers were all super helpful and super nice. One of the other con staff that was really helpful and kept checking on us a lot was Heya. Because day one, she was Han. Day two, she dressed up as Leia. So I told her I was going to call her Heya.
Hey, and let's face it, she'll always be royalty to me.
I know.
And we really, really appreciate all the stuff that you did for us, Heya.
Thank you.
Once all of the time issues were ironed out, we actually went back to our room, you know, got all checked in, got comfy, and rested a little because the weekend was going to be hectic enough as is. So then when it was time,
we started the Forged and Foam class, got day one out of the way, got all the prep work, got all the other fun stuff going on. There should be a separate video for that Forged and Foam class. And then we managed to head out to the floor. However, we did not get a whole lot of time out on the vendor floor. We barely managed to get through most of the first area, not even the full area, much less the second room. That might have been my fault a little bit because the first room had my Lego minifigs, so I spent a little time there.
A little, please. They did announce overhead that the headliner guest, Kevin Sorbo,
Hercules, Hercules!
His panel was starting, so we hurried up and went in there.
Yeah, we weren't going to miss that.
Now, just one little nitpicky thing here. It was kind of weird having Kevin Sorbo's panel on the Friday instead of Saturday. Mm-hmm. And there were a couple of people, congoers that we had talked to, that they were a little concerned that they had missed that. However, for their sake, and, you know, for our own memory's sake, we did record the whole thing, and we hope to have a video of that up as well.
As soon as the panel was over, of course, there was pictures and autographs, so we got over there, got in line, picked out the right print that we wanted.
We're gonna get our picture and paper signed.
Waited for our turn, and when we got up to the front, the gentleman taking our money happened to be Braeden Sorbo, Kevin Sorbo's son. And we chatted him up for a little while, found out he does his own little Instagram and all kinds of fun stuff. So we're going to leave a link down below so you can check him out. He was a lot of fun to talk to.
He really was. Super nice. And I mean,
super nerdy.
Oh, yeah. I was about to say, we could have probably spent the rest of the evening just nerding out with him.
In fact, I think he was getting a little bit in trouble because he was talking to us so much and not taking other people's money. But then we got up there. We got our autograph. And we got a nice picture taken with Mr. Sorbo. And you got to do something really cool.
Oh my gosh. I got to put the most fantastic notch on my belt ever. My belt of nerdom now has the notch for the Hercules handshake with Kevin Sorbo himself.
Alien right now.
Yes.
In Spartacus class. We need the fake tan they put on me now too. And I'll get
there. Thank you so much. Growing up watching Hercules, me and my buddies, we would shake each other's hand the way he would. And we would always call it the Hercules handshake. So, and I'm so thrilled.
I know, so cool.
It means the world to me that Mr. Sorbo was kind enough to indulge me with that.
The thing I think that was so cool is the minute you said it, he's like, of course. He wasn't like, oh gosh, here we go. He was super nice. I enjoyed talking to him. But I just love the fact that when they just go with things. I love it when people can do that.
Once we had our Kevin Sorbo goodies, we did go back out to the floor, but it was pretty late at this point. Most of the vendors had closed up. We figured we might as well tuck in for the night.
Yep.
And save some of that energy for day two. Ah, yes. Day two was the big one.
So we headed backstage where the class was, and we put some more work in on our bracers. And once that was finished, then we headed back onto the floor. And this time, we finally had time to check out the whole floor.
One of the first places we had to go was to that other vendor hall, since we did not get to see it at all on day one.
Yep.
And there were so many great booths over here. First of all, for the Lego fanatic,
Oh my gosh. You
would have been in heaven here.
So awesome. Love Legos, and I love when the Lego clubs get there and they set up all of their little mini towns and little dioramas, and oh my gosh, it was so much fun.
Lego decided that they were going to expand their minifig lines, and they came out with a pirate line. The very first year that they actually had custom faces was in this line. This actual display, there's known to be less than five of them in America for Kmart stores. They did a collaboration in 1989 with Lego and expanded, and this is an actual display piece from Kmart. This ship in this display actually has firing cannons, but in America, the ships didn't have firing cannons because they wouldn't pass safety. But this is the very first ship that they actually did in the pirate line, and the pirate captain, which was new. All the elements you see here, the ship sails, island pieces, the greenery. So this was a really big deal. This was a gamble for Lego to actually start up, and this was the best gamble they ever did, because the pirate line arguably is what made Lego popular in America. The ship I have above is a custom ship built off of the newer ship styles. They actually released a ship, a limited edition ship, called the Imperial Flagship. And this model that I built is actually about 4.5 of those combined to build a big, large ship. This ship is full interiored, so you can take it apart. And there's cannons. There's over 100 crewmen on this ship right now.
Well, he's the service old guy.
Can I pet your service dog?
Is it okay to pet you? I don't recommend it. He's kind of bitey.
Is he bitey?
He's bitey.
But then I would just run. My emotional support animal is running through the... Oh, I would run through the mini golf. That would be great.
Something cool about this hall was there were like everything you could imagine. I mean, there were tabletop games from the Branson Board Game Cafe. And the swords. Oh my goodness,
I know.
The swords.
One of my favorite booths. He was back again with all of his foam weapons. Love that guy. Love when he shows up. He has great foam weapons and great prices too. You also liked the other sword guy booth.
I liked the other one because they were swords made out of metal, not foam.
Well, you know what? You're stronger than I am.
And they had some great swords. Legend of Zelda swords, so the Master Sword was on hand.
And the Dark Sword.
They had so many great fantasy and anime-based swords. And the Buster Sword made out of metal. And let me tell you,
heavy.
Irish Mike was right. That thing's gonna give you a hernia.
There were a couple of swords I literally could not lift. They were so heavy. But I could lift the supernatural Angel Blade and Archangel Blade.
Ooh. I can kill some angels. And now... an archangel.
We also found a fun booth that had some really cool and unique horror-themed merch. Yeah, everything from toys to shirts and everything.
I will say, they were creeping me out a bit, though, with their cosplay that was going
on. What? Oh, come on. It's just a birthday, boy. Renfest love was in full swing, both with Dragonfest, our very local Renaissance festival.
Yes. And then the not too far away White Hart.
I can't wait.
I am super excited.
Huzzah!
We also happened to see one of our new favorite artists and comic book writers. We may just have got something from him as well. Back out to that main vendor hall, and this time we had to take advantage of one of the artists on hand. She's always creating the most epic pictures right there on the spot.
Yes.
And it was time for us to get our own piece.
Yeah. She's so good and so talented and so fast.
Yes, she really is.
Hi, I'm Andie Scott, Cartoons by Andie. I run a small business based out of St. Louis, but I travel all over the Midwest. I do caricatures, commissions, custom artwork, pretty much anything artsy I can manage. I've got my custom buttons as well. They're pretty unique. They have little extra bits glued on, and I can do custom orders of those online. I have a shop at Etsy at Cartoons by Andie, and I also post, I try to post daily drawings on Instagram and Twitter, but that doesn't always work out, but I post kind of regularly. And yeah, I just do a little fun artsy business.
Something I feel like you can only find at conventions, unless you spend hours scouring the internet to find just the right piece, are custom figures. There was a guy there creating all kinds of custom toys, and it was hilarious stuff. I think there was a certain space-themed franchise that you were really enjoying to finally see some toys for.
Yeah, Spaceballs the merchandise.
He even had the Force, if you're interested. Hey, look at that. The dark side of the Force.
And then each one of the Infinity Stones has their own light and are magnetic.
Wow, so sit there.
He also had some beautiful resin ghost or a spirit. And when you put them on a light pedestal, they were just beautiful.
My name's Brad Roselli. I'm the director of Top Tier Figures. We're based out of Kansas City at the Arts Asylum. For the last 12 years, I've been building up the company, worked with 24 different artists from around the world, and we all pool our resources and our talents. So we make every kind of figure you can imagine out of whatever material we have laying around. Like, for instance, this is that made out of an old kitchen glove. And now it's an Infinity Gauntlet with some add-ons. At the Arts Asylum, it's a very unique place where we're freely able to express ourselves. We'll work on any kind of thing a person wants. Our best way to reach us is through our website at toptierfigures.com. We'll work on anything a person wants to have made.
Another booth had some horror-themed love to it, and this guy, he was thinking because he used his little bit of space and went vertical and had a lot more show space. So, nicely done. And jumping back on the topic of fantastic art, Musetap Studios were on hand, so it was nice to see them. Might have got a little something from them as well.
Spoilers.
And let me tell you, this convention was so huge, it was literally spilling out into the grounds.
The insides were on the outsides.
You just got to say that you were proud.
past this. Okay, come on, cry. Cry, babe, where's the sun? I need to stare right into its face.
No, no.
Yeah, that's what hit the sun.
No, you have to stay here longer. You can stay here. You can stay here. You're next.
We can't spend all day wandering around the vendor halls because we took a little time to check out the slap fight.
Yeah, I had no idea this was a real thing. I thought this was just something that they kind of cooked up that it would be fun and they were going to pull people like from the audience or whatever. But no, this is apparently a traveling thing. It's a real thing.
And that's why we have the corner man. Yeah, make some noise. That was a good hit. And he's still smiling.
Apparently people online had heard about it and know about it, so I guess I'm in the dark on that one.
Where'd that one come from?
But it was kind of interesting. At first I was like, I don't care to see people slap each other. But then when we sat down and started watching it, I could not stop watching it. And it was just fascinating. And it was really fun to watch grown men just slap the crap out of people.
Nice. I can see your your cheek is swollen up. It's only gonna get bigger. However, he is the current heavyweight champion. You are the only undefeated slap fight champion. Is that correct?
That's hella correct.
Caught him by the ear. Crazy Hawaiian got hit, and he just made a mean face.
And obviously, we weren't the only ones having fun because they had quite the draw in this room,
they
too.
They did.
But again, we do have a winner. It was unanimous. Your winner is Darius the Destroyer! Have you been doing that since you were little?
No, my mom just beat me a lot.
Only here at Slap Fight.
Right after the Slap Fest was one of our favorite things at conventions, the cosplay contest.
Yes, first and foremost, going around the vendor floors, we were seeing so many fantastic cosplayers. It is always so much fun to see them walking around, to get that chance to interact with them, maybe toss some lines their way, and they're always so nice and so willing to reciprocate and pose for a picture. Seriously, one of our favorite things with any convention is always the cosplayers.
They had quite the contestants this time. There was like 60 entries, and it was some amazing costumes.
It really was. So many great costumes, and so varied as well. Even though there were 60 of them, I do have to say, they went through them very quickly. And I'm a little torn on that. On the one hand, I'm like, oh, but, you know, I like when they have their own music and their own chants and, you know, they get that moment to shine and everything and you really get to see them. But on the other hand, I'm not going to lie, with that many awesome cosplayers, yeah, to be able to get through them that quickly, it's like, okay, not bad, because we do get to see them and it kind of keeps that show going at a little more brisk pace.
Yeah. So kudos to the cosplayers. kudos to the MCs, the Nerd Informants, and kudos to the BransonCon for doing an amazing cosplay contest.
And kudos to the judges for actually being able to choose winners. I wouldn't want that pressure.
Oh, yeah.
No thanks.
Definitely.
We've got a whole separate video of the cosplay contest in its entirety, so anybody that missed it or just want to check it out again, there you guys go. I did have a few issues with the stage in general. When you think of all of the panels and cosplay contests, you would think a stage would be the perfect place for that. Maybe not a theater stage. That stage was elevated quite a bit with that stadium seating. The further back you went to get that nice level shot, the further back away from the cosplayers you're going to be. With where they were on the stage, and it was a big stage.
It was a big stage.
It was still pretty hard to see them, even when you were front and center. That wasn't just restricted to the cosplay contest. When Kevin Sorbo was doing his panel, they had a really great setup on stage. You know, it was a comfy couch and a comfy chair. Uh-huh. Again, that stage, it's lifted so high, that stadium seating. They did have, usually, the camera pointed on him or the cosplayers, and you could see on the bigger screens what was going on. Sometimes the lights seemed to be a little too bright, and that did seem to obscure the action just a little bit, whether it was the panel or the cosplayers. You know, those lights aren't exactly fine-tuned for that smaller scale.
Yeah, it sometimes washed them out a little bit, and you couldn't really see some of the really good details.
Right. Once the contest was finished, we managed to get just a little more time out on the floor. We had one more thing to do to cap off our day two. What would that last event be?
Why, a VIP screening with Kevin Sorbo himself, and we got to watch an episode of Hercules with Kevin Sorbo while he commentated. That was like our childhood just realized, and it was so amazing because we're getting to watch our favorite TV show with the star.
That was so much fun. And on top of that, and in another video, there was an impromptu Q&A as he was waiting to get everything started and give people time to get into the theater.
One of my favorite things though from that Q&A was him showing us how he did the famous arrow catch.
Yes!
And they whip pan, and you go, and you're like there. And it works. It works.
What an awesome way to end day two. Another shout out to Heya. Here it is, day three, final day of the convention. Our day started off
basically straight back to class because this was our time to completely finish up our bracers and any other projects that were going on. We were all able to go out on stage and present them to the convention, and we got to show them off. We got to follow Bruce over to get a picture signed for his grandson.
Hi, Bruce. Oh, the Shieldmaker. How are you doing?
I'm doing good.
Pleasure.
You are a fan of Bendy of the Ink Machine, or, you know, I don't know, maybe a little fella named Claptrap from Borderlands,
what?
Then you would probably recognize David Eddings.
This gives you an idea of some of the stuff
beautiful.
That I do.
That is amazing. That's a, it's actually, my goodness. May I try it on?
Oh, absolutely.
He was great with
he
the
was.
People that he was dealing
yeah,
with, too.
Yeah, he was.
There you go.
Yeah. There we go.
Over here, David.
Because you're never jealous.
Sandra, we'll always have the time we made your boyfriend jealous. It took a little bit. I had to get it right.
And once that was done, it was time to head back out on the floor and go back to any vendors we wanted to go see.
It also gave us just a little more time to talk to everyone, especially some of the people that we are getting to know in the convention circuit. And let's face it, that's one of the things that makes going to conventions so much fun. Your con friends, when you get to see them. We also like to talk to the vendors about their experience. For the most part, everyone seemed to really enjoy it. They thought that it was good. Honestly, the only issues we ever heard were kind of the same ones that we've already talked about. The split rooms was kind of weird to some of them. Apparently, there were some different hours in place. The secondary room, it would close a little earlier than the first room. And that may have been more the resort because they wanted to close the restaurant or the gift shop down.
Something that I was super excited about was the Lego people changed their
diorama to
Hoth.
I don't know why they call it Hoth. They should call it Cold.
That was so cool. We didn't know they were going to change it up. And there was a bunch of really fun Easter eggs.
Jim, robot camels.
There are always so many fun Easter eggs.
Yeah, I do believe Elsa was there helping the battle. My biggest con for the con was the fact that there was no program. That was my biggest pet peeve. And then usually there's always nice little bios of the stars that are going to be there or the people that are working the show, some vendor lists. So I really always enjoy those.
That's actually a great point about the bios for some of the guests and everything. Maybe not everyone knows all of your celebrity guests, and having that little bit of information would kind of be a nice way to maybe introduce someone. There were so many guests at BransonCon that even though there were 3 days, we didn't get a chance to see.
No.
They had a bunch of Power Rangers there. They had one of the singers from Sailor Moon there. They had a magician on hand, for Christ's sake.
That was too quick. I'll do it one more time for you.
I mean, there were so many great stars there, and we didn't even get a chance to see them because sometimes, you know, we would be in class during that. But other times we might be elsewhere in another panel or just on the floor because that was our only time to be on the floor. And of course, there's always going to be that overlap at a convention. But sometimes when you have that program, that might help maybe better manage your time, and we may not be the best at managing our time sometimes.
Now, I do understand that sometimes people don't want to waste the money on printing those because they're people just toss them or, you know, don't even get them and you've got just all of these things just left over. Some conventions that we've gone to use an app called Fan Guru. It puts everything on the app. You can click on the events you want to go to. It sets reminders. So then your phone goes off letting you know, hey, it's time for this panel or it's time for this cosplay contest. The best thing about the convention, in my opinion, just how nice and genuine and pleasant all the volunteers and staff were. They were so super helpful. They kind of made you forget any issues you had right away because they were so willing to help you and try to correct things. And so I really appreciated that.
My biggest con to the con, honestly, it was just the location. I think that the Welks Resort Theater is a great place. It's a gorgeous setup. I don't think the layout was very conducive for a convention. The whole split room thing, I think that having the gift shop and the restaurant, splitting those up, you know, that might have stopped a couple of people, had them thinking maybe I'm going the wrong way. Again, my nitpicks with the stage and some of the events at a convention, you kind of want to be a lot closer upper to see what's going on. Other than that, though, I mean, the fact that they were able to use this location as well as they did is nothing short of amazing. Although, I think that they're already planning a different venue next year, so we'll see what the future holds for BransonCon. And then my pro, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to copy off you. Seriously, the staff and the volunteers, they had so much stuff going on. Conventions are the most stressful things in the world, I'm sure, for the people that are running them behind the scenes, but never once did they, you know, just blow up or explode or anything. Once more, guys, kudos to you for your effort. Thank you so much for making our weekend, and I'm sure so many others, their weekend so awesome. We had a great time at BransonCon, and we're already ready for year three.
Looking
so let's bring it on.
Yeah.
At this point, we'd love to remind you guys to leave a like on the video if you happen to like it. Drop some comments down below, especially if you were at BransonCon. Let us know maybe what were some of your biggest cons and pros, because constructive criticism is always great feedback just to make the experience all the more better. Or just tell us some of your best memories, especially if it's anything to do with Kevin Sorbo or Hercules, because that's my childhood right there.
So awesome.
Don't forget to subscribe, hit that notification bell, and
don't forget to like us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram so you know where we're going, because we got a whole lot of stuff planned. And we've got merchandise over on TeePublic. Check us out on the Retro Refresh. If we like it,
we nerd it. Totally.
For BransonCon. One of the other
Staff.
Thank you. One of the other staff members that was super helpful with we started the forms of... Ready? Thanks, Paul.
Paul! Quiet on the set. Don't wink at me.
Hi, Dad. Pirates, 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 pirates. Until I would stand back. No, that's stupid. Cut that out, Tom. That was dumb. All of that was dumb.
Into the grounds.
And quite the hootin' and the hollerin'. Yes, ladies, I'm 80 from the Ozarks.
And it was... That stadium feet. Jesus.